but I wrote But Beautiful while living in New York. And what was really useful is that I'd make up these tapes of all of the music of whichever musician I was writing about, and then I'd wander around the streets. And like that, it meant that the stuff I was seeing in that weird way of synesthesia, if you like, what I was seeing would be kind of infused with the music. And so there'd be this constant kind of traffic between what I was seeing or what I was hearing. And the idea really was, because I don't know anything about music, and I just loved jazz so much and wanted to find out about it, but all of the books that I was reading, none of them were really conveying to me what was so exciting about the music. And since I don't have recourse to musical terminology, I'd start using metaphors. And of course, once you start using a metaphor, you move into the realm of the fictive. And so I found that what I would do is I'd try to describe music in terms of, well, like invented scenes. You know, I'm one of these writers, I've been a real sponge, actually, in terms of absorbing influences. So, but what happened, I found, is that even when I was really most under the influence of somebody, even when I was trying hardest to sound like somebody else, I'd always end up sounding like myself still. And actually, that's the way that jazz musicians have tended to end up with their own sound. You know, Miles Davis wanted to sound like Dizzy Gillespie, but couldn't, so he ended up sounding like Miles Davis. And I guess the writer under whose spell I fell for the longest period of time would be Thomas Bernhard. And the Lawrence book particularly has got that Bernhardian rant, that kind of that incessant mad repetition. So Out of Sheer Rage starts with this conceit where I claim I'm trying to write a serious academic study of D.H. Lawrence, but really that is just a premise, because it was always going to be a really wild, crazy book. The way I thought it was best to approach that would be to claim that I was trying to write a very straight academic book. That was never my intention. And one of the things I do in that book is construct a kind of really extreme argument about the inadequacies of that kind of standard academic approach to writing. I mean, what you got was weirdly a kind of complete inversion of the traditional hierarchy of genre. So I liked the travel books more than the novels, I liked the essays, and my favorite bits of Lawrence were actually the letters. There's this great line of Lawrence's when he was commissioned to write a book about Thomas Hardy. He said, you know, out of sheer rage I've begun my book on Thomas Hardy. So far it's about everything but Thomas Hardy. So I thought it'd be nice to write a book which, if it was about a book about D.H. Lawrence, which was maybe not about everything but D.H. Lawrence, but was about a lot of other things as well. I went to live in Paris thinking I'd write my version of Scott Fitzgerald's Tender is the Night, and didn't make any progress with it, actually, and ended up writing another book before I got round to this one. And then by the time I did get round to doing it, in terms of my taste in music, I'd kind of immatured with age, really, in that I'd gone from really liking jazz to liking trance and techno. And that was useful, I think, because, of course, part of that thing is this whole ecstasy experience. And it seems to me that, you know, in the Fitzgerald book, what happens to Dick Diver? Well, he becomes an alcoholic, drinks too much. And, of course, by our time now, there's no real glamour attached to boozing in the way that there was back in the 1920s. But there was this exciting thing of, you know, of ecstasy. And inevitably, of course, there is the aftermath, there's the come down. And in a way, that Paris Trance is dealing with, you know, what happens after you've had this completely ecstatic period. And I mean ecstatic not just in the literal sense of people taking drugs, but this perfect romance which this couple experience when they're very young. And for the central character, that's sort of enough for him for life, really. When Paris Trance came out, several of the reviewers said, yeah, but there's nothing special about this guy, he's just a kind of, you know, he's just a hedonist, somebody who just wants to get wasted. But I still feel a kind of a great fondness for him.